Hey, Auto Squad, producer Dylan here, and I'm excited to tell you we are bringing back our first ever series of the show back in the main feed, Spider-Man Miles Morales. This first episode, Hello Tiny Spiders, was originally released way back on June 30th, 2021. In this episode, we talked about how exhilarating it is to swing around New York City, question Peter's coffee drinking techniques, and really dive into why we love Spider-Man as a character. So enjoy this episode of AutoSave right now.
Welcome to the very first episode of AutoSave. I'm Nick Andrade, and I'm with my co-host Camille Salazar Hadaway as we dive into our very first game, Spider-Man Miles Morales. On today's episode, we're going to cover a very action-packed and hectic first mission of the game. But first, Camille, how are you doing today?
I am doing good, and I'm excited to dive into Miles Morales. I have my thwips ready. Thwip. Yeah, that's the best sound effect.
Do you remember those silly string, those web shooters?
Yes. Oh, as a kid, yeah. You could like dress up as Spider-Man and put silly string, you know, bulky silly string on your wrist and act like Spider-Man.
I had those. I just shot my cousins.
Yeah, oh, really?
They hated me for it. Yeah, I just saw.
How was the cleanup afterwards?
I don't know, because my mom and my aunt probably cleaned it up after us. But it was fun as a child, and there was no, you know, remorse for it.
You know what? That, though, has me wondering. In New York, who cleans up all the webs? Do they just dissipate? Is there a cleaning crew?
I don't know. It's especially, like, even the debris of like fighting, like who cleans up this stuff? I know it's like it costs millions of dollars for all of this stuff to get cleaned up.
Taxes are high in New York. Yep.
Yes, they are. I think that's the reason why. Miles Morales, why did we pick this game?
Well, I think it's because Miles Morales is, you know, we all know of Peter Parker. We all know that Spider-Man, but Miles Morales is kind of like our Spider-Man. Miles Morales is a diverse way of looking at a superhero. We don't usually get a spotlight on a character who is Afro-Latino. Me being, you know, Black and Indian, I kind of gravitate to the story of Miles. I have to admit, I didn't know much about Miles until Into the Spider-Verse came out. But through that movie, I immediately fell in love because it was instantly relatable for me. You know, growing up as a gamer, Blade was that other character related to. There weren't that other characters out there that looked like me. So for Miles, and that connection that Miles has to a certain community, and you know, this is echoed throughout the game. It just means so much. I think I've cried like so many times. I've played this game about 4 times, and there's that reason I keep going back, right?
Yeah, I mean, it's emotional, just like every regular day task, and seeing Miles and seeing the type of character he is. Again, I always gravitate towards the good guys, so you know, seeing the way he is, it's just emotional, and his family dynamic and everything is just great. But otherwise, it's the first big PS5 game.
Yes,
and I think that's really important thing. There's not many releases right now, and that was the launch release on the PS5, and so we want to take a look at that. But you know, the graphics and everything just look insane.
Yes, definitely showcasing the PlayStation 5's power. And, you know, I think there's a lot of people who are like, this is only available on PlayStation 5. Ah, I can't play. There's no PlayStation 5s around. But it's also available on PlayStation 4. Just doesn't look as beautiful because fidelity mode on the PlayStation 5, just those reflections. Ah, yeah. Beautiful.
And there's like no loading times, right?
Yes, there's, well, even when you start up the game, you know, and he's the subway and you're hearing the theme and it's like a banger. And then you go right into the game. You're like, whoa, what is this?
X and right away he's starting, like this cutscene's already happening. I'm like, what's going on?
Yeah.
This is incredible. No loading screens. I love that. But the main thing that I want to hit on, obviously, is what Spider-Man means to us. In general, for me, Spider-Man is the first character that I ever gravitated towards as a kid. I loved him. I loved him in the 1990s show. That was where I really learned a lot about Spider-Man. And again, that's where my whole love of good characters come from. As a kid, I always cheer for the good guy because Spider-Man was almost altruistic. Like, he is just such a good person.
Yeah, Spider-Man, well, a lot of Marvel characters, and this is why I kind of gravitated to Spider-Man as well with the 90s cartoon growing up on that. Peter Parker was just a kid going through high school, then going through college, had relationship problems. And Marvel tends to focus on, like you said, the everyday of a person. Whether they're a superhero or not, there's those everyday challenges. It may be picking up the groceries yeah. so your Aunt May could cook. So for me, yes, Spider-Man was that relatable character. And, you know, Spider-Man, there's a bunch of iterations of different types of spider people yes. plus pig that it makes the world so exciting and new that, you know, you have this mantle of this character that kind of dons the Spider-Man mask, but there's so many different iterations and it means different things to different people. So for Miles Morales, like I mentioned, like it's very relatable for me that seeing someone like me in a game and having New York come alive. I visited New York so many times, I have family in New York, and seeing those boroughs come alive, they did it so well.
I remember, especially the first Spider-Man game, going through New York. I had recently just come from New York. And I knew every little place that I'd been, like in Midtown, right by the Statue of Liberty, like all those little places. Like I was seeing them in real time. And it's like a 3D complete model of New York City, correct?
They do it so well. They do New York so well. And Spider-Man is that mantle character for Marvel, right? Spider-Man was that character that had all these TV shows, these animation shows for kids, the Japanese live action show.
Wow, that's a shout out.
Yeah, so it's like whenever you see anything with Spider-Man's name on it, you could understand that Marvel, especially now, is so protective. Whenever they put this in, for example, Insomniac's hand back with the original Spider-Man game that came out, how long ago was that? I'm trying to remember. Was that,
I think it was 2018?
2018, I was going to say 2017, but yeah, 2018, they have to believe that these developers, this studio is going to do that character justice. And Insomniac just keeps, with the traversing, when you first experience that in the original Spider-Man game, they do it so well. And, you know, we'll get into Miles and how that works within this game, but you just see them make these improvements. It's really hard to come out with a sequel to a game that was so successful and then have the sequel, well, kind of mid-sequel, be as successful as that.
So where we've seen Miles before, if you don't know who Miles Morales is, I think his main coming out party for everyone is Into the Spider-Verse, which is probably one of the best movies of all time.
Please stop sticking. Please keep
Wait.
How could there be two Spider-Men? There can't be two Spider-Men. Can there?
Out of town for a few days. I'll hit you when I'm back. Peace.
No. It's not possible. It's just puberty. It's a normal spider and I'm a normal kid.
Yeah, it is the best movie of all time. And they're working on the sequel and I can't wait. I have that on like my Google alerts. Every bit of news I want to know about that sequel. It's just such a good movie because, like I said, you have all these different spider people plus Pig, and they come together and they still manage to make those animation styles stand out, but also be cohesive. Like, I don't know how they pitch that movie, but props to them. Props to them.
Yeah. It's like we have a vision. Kind of understand us where we can't really dive too deep in what we want, but it's a ride. It's like psychedelic too. And there's so many different layers and so many amazing characters that you can grasp onto. But Miles, especially, like you exactly. feel for him, just like in the game, in the movie, it's the same thing.
Exactly. And in the movie, you really see Miles' origin story, right? And you see how he's just a kid trying to get by. You know, his trouble is that he got transferred to a new school and he doesn't like it. He just wants to go back to his old school and, you know, seeing his classmates that he knows throughout the years. And he's trying to adapt to this new life. And, you know, you see the quirks of like also him hitting puberty / getting powers, like they coincide. And there's just so much charm to Miles. And authenticity that it's really hard not to kind of fall in love with that character and want to know more about his story. And you get more from PlayStation 4. They also had Miles in that, the PlayStation 4 Spider-Man game, where you're introduced to Miles in the gameverse and he gets his powers near the end of that game.
Yeah, so in the first game, when we do see him, unfortunately, his dad dies from a terrorist attack by the demons. So that's his kind of origin is similar to Peter's in terms of losing a father figure and losing a loved one. And I think this is where like the mantle of being such a good hero and trying to help people really comes to light. So that's where we left off with him. And then in the DLC as well, he's trying to train to become a Spider-Man. And the main game, Peter is kind of shrugging him off. And in the DLC, finally trains Miles. And so that's the lead up to this. In the comics version, I think this is where it all kicked off in terms of his popularity. When he was introduced, I think he became one of the most popular Marvel characters at the time. That's why they just kept pumping him out. And again, like you said, the relatable factor and just having a different background, I think means a lot to people, and that shone in the comics, and now it shows in these games.
I could say it over and over again, and I will.
Yeah. Well, you cried four times
already. I think we've all seen characters like Peter Parker as superheroes over and over again. I think it's just much more interesting to see different types of people kind of take the mantle and that responsibility, which Miles, you know, throughout the game, we'll see kind of struggles with carrying that mantle.
After the break, we tackle the first mission of Miles Morales on AutoSave. Welcome back to AutoSave, and let's finally unpack the start of this game. And it's mission one. It's titled Hold On to Your Web Shooters. But before we get to that, what difficulty did you play on?
Normal. I was so quick to answer that one because I know a lot of people shy away from playing on normal, but you know,
I'm openly normal.
We're normal. But no, I always go to that because firstly, when I play a game, then I'm trying to beat it. Usually I'm covering it. I'm working in the gaming industry. But yeah, so I played on normal. And then when I went back, I did play four times. Then I played on amazing. Spectacular was really hard.
I don't want to get too much into it, but like spectacular, like how do you even, because I've tried once on the original game and it's a nightmare. I would say I'm a moderately good gamer, but I have to be on normal or else I don't get mad playing games, but I'll get mad if that makes sense.
No, I hear you. You definitely get really intense. There were a lot of moments where my significant other was just like, it's just a game. And I'm like, it's Spider-Man, Miles Morales, the nerdum came out. But yeah, because you're trying to make all these different combos, right? The combat is similar to the Arkham games, right? Where you want to try to do a chain of combos to kind of unlock, you know, certain aspects of the mission, like certain check marks you just kind of notch off. So it's tough, spectacular. I didn't last long.
Yeah, even I remember in the DLC in the first game, I think they upped the ante in normal. And normal is, I would say it's still pretty challenging.
It has its challenges. Although at the beginning, I feel like it is pretty soft. I think when I chose normal, and I'm not sure if you had this as well, if you were kind of like, oh, maybe I should have went a little bit harder on this one. But yeah, it picks up definitely.
So if we set the scene, it's Christmas Eve in Harlem, which any game that's during Christmas makes me happy because I'm a Christmas elf and I absolutely love Christmas. So just seeing that it was wintertime, not summer, because, you know, summer's always every game because whatever. This is wintertime. It's Christmas time. It's happy festive time. And Miles is walking up from the subway.
Yes.
Looking fresh. Music's going. He's got his nice, you know, I hope it's faux fur jacket.
I'm pretty sure it's faux fur. He's a Spider-Man. I think he understands being for the animals.
And that's just great artwork. Well, I'll have to say, like, everything looks spectacular. We mentioned it with the PS5. It looks really good. We both played it on the PS5. But just everything looks a notch better than before. Mm-hmm. And the character styles, the buildings, just everything looks really fresh.
Yeah, when you get that opening scene and you kind of get a sense of the liveliness of the city, walking through the snow, you see Miles, you see him interacting with different people. It just immediately captures you. What better to welcome, you know, gamers into this world than welcoming them to like a party, right?
Yeah.
There's no other way to do it.
No, exactly. Especially in New York. You want some party atmosphere. We finally then, right after, see Miles in his Spider-Man costume. It looks pretty knackered. He's wearing like a jean hoodie, which I don't know about jean hoodies. I'm not a big fan. You know, we're both from Canada, but
you're not into the Canadian tuxedo, no.
Yeah, that's I forgot what it was called. But he looks pretty cool. And then that's when we start swinging around the city so that we can chase up after Peter, who's calling us. And right away, what did you think of the swing style?
It feels completely different than what you have in the 2018 game for Spider-Man. That Spider-Man, he's been Spider-Man for a while. He's experienced. So his swings are smooth, but also like a little stiff. It's kind of a weird feeling that you get from Peter Parker. They're very like where he swings, he knows exactly what he's doing. It's kind of like robotic. You're going through the motions. When you start swinging as Miles, you see him kind of frailing around when he's at the peak of his swing, trying to capture, like grab the air. And like, it's kind of like, you know, back to the Spider-Man, Tobey Maguire Spider-Man movies, where he's trying to figure out his web slinging.
Go web, go!
Yeah. Go web, go! You have kind of those moments where you're swinging with Miles and you're like, wait, is he gonna fall? Like,
yeah.
This is kind of unsettling, but at the same time, so refreshing to watch. And for me, it's just like, it feels more natural because I don't know about you, but I'm not graceful at all.
No, I'm so clumsy, 100%.
Yeah, if I was a spider person, I would not be able to be as, you know, graceful as Peter Parker does it. And I would probably look like Miles frailing around at his jumps.
I think this is what Insomniac does really well, is these little things that you might not notice sometimes, but like it's accurate and they make it accurate. And that's just a good thing to notice. And I think there's an unlockable that wasn't in the first game with skimmers, where if you almost fall down to the road and then you pick yourself back up, you get this kind of bonus. I thought that was really cool because, again, Miles could fall at any moment, but he didn't because he just got it in time. But he's not that good.
No, he's not that good. But it's like his own style. He brings his own type of style to swinging. You could tell he's it reminds me, if you've seen Into the Spider-Verse, okay, and you see Miles kind of swinging around for the first time after he kind of has the body of Peter Parker with him.
Yeah.
It's like that. It's really where you get a sense that you know, his web is leading him rather than him having control over the web. And it brings his own style. As we see when we progress through the game, he kind of adapts to that. And that becomes kind of his way of swinging, although he has total control.
I still, the Tobey Maguire go. I remember watching that in theaters and that made me crack up. I was like 12 years old and I'm like, this is incredible. Cause he like, I think the music crescendoed, like he's going to swing. And then he's like, nothing's happening.
But exactly. Yeah,
I like that. Cause that's the same thing with Miles.
It is. And remember Into the Spider-Verse as well, when Miles was going to make his first leap and then he got intimidated by how tall the building was and then goes down the stairs and goes to a smaller building. And you know, that kind of humor is kind of in the swing as well. It's more realistic. Like, yeah, this could be really scary. This is really dangerous. So I loved how they were able to kind of keep that authentic.
Plus, you can do your own style moves in the air. Mm-hmm. So it's like your own Tony Hawk Pro Skater in the air. And you get bonus points for doing cartwheels or spin moves. Or I'm trying to think of skater terms. 360,
360 ollie pipe. Ollies. Yeah. A shove pop. I don't know. I skateboard, but I don't do tricks.
Oh, you skateboard? Oh, incredible.
Yeah, I do. Skateboard and snowboard. I'm better at snowboarding because of the grace of the snow softening my falls.
You said you're not very graceful, but you skateboard and snowboard. That's pretty graceful. I've tried and I cannot do it.
Just have a little snow by the side. You know, we'll set up our own web shooters to catch you if you fall.
Oh, perfect. Next time, yeah. Thank you. I appreciate it. Once we catch up to Peter, he talks to Miles, and I got to bring this up, the coffee. Mm-hmm. Peter's upside down and drinking coffee with the cup on the other way. It just doesn't make sense. You can still hold it properly and drink it, Peter.
Maybe showing off.
No.
I think this is a moment where Peter's like, hey, have you tried drinking coffee upside down?
Yeah.
Because that's what real Spider-Men do.
But like, Peter, you're a 20-something and Miles is 16. Like, why are you trying to show off to him? I don't know what the prison is called. Rikers, I think, is the actual prison in New York. But I don't know if that's the prison in Spider-Man. But something goes wrong. And Miles tries to fix it. Doesn't happen. The container goes sprawling onto the sidewalk. And in comes a villain.
Hello, tiny spiders.
This moment is so great because it's setting up the fact that, you know, Miles is kind of an inexperienced Spider-Man. He's still figuring things out. He's kind of the reason why the container kind of sprawls out into the road.
Yeah.
You know, he miscalculated, definitely. And we see this inexperience in other iterations of Miles, because although we all know Miles is Spider-Man, this is still his origin story that we're kind of piecing together from the previous game. So when this happens, obviously you could see that he has the guilt, but he has to deal with this villain that just kind of comes out of the container. And this is a classic Spider-Man villain who always is in one of the first appearances of any Spider-Man property. It's obviously Rhino.
I just love his, like, is he Russian? Is he not Russian? I know he is in this game, like, hello, tiny spiders. But like, that was a bad impression, by the way. But he's definitely always a villain that comes first for like the inexperienced Spider-Man, because clearly he's on like the bottom of the totem pole of villains, right?
Yeah, exactly. You wouldn't put Green Goblin, Hobgoblin in there at first. You got to work your way up. This is like the Spider-Man 101 training camp. They call up Rhino. They're like, hey, Rhino. Training camp time. Let's go. But this Rhino is definitely a suited up. He looks a bit different than what we've seen him to be before, has a lot of tech on him, and proves to be a little bit difficult. Although this fight is pretty easy, I would say.
We first start, I think Peter starts riding Rhino. And then we have to chase up after him. And then that's when we face a couple goons. And that's our initial introduction to the combat system. So I wanted to know, like, we don't do any stealth at the moment, but it's strictly all melee. What did you think of this combat system? I know it's, like you said, the Batman Arkham games, but how did you feel in comparison to the last game as well? How did it feel to you?
Honestly, you know, it kind of feels the same because you don't get the uniqueness of Miles's full power because he's still developing that. It's just a melee fight. They do the classic, you know, web shooters on Rhino and then riding Rhino through, I think it was a mall, which that was pretty cool. Just how they set up that scene, because you're kind of being pulled through like these openings in the wall or crevices as you're trying to hold on to Rhino while he just stampedes through. I think it's a mall.
No, it's a mall.
It is a mall, right? And he's avoiding a bunch of, you know, shoppers, a bunch of people who just are like trying to get their, just picking up, you know, supplies. They just see this Rhino stampeding through. So we've seen kind of those tropes in other Spider-Man games. Not only the 2018 games, but the ones before that. But they've done it so many times that it's perfected. Then when you get to this fight, you actually get a sense of Miles's healing power. So as you're fighting off different prisoners, before you kind of catch a ride on the Rhino train, it's prompting you through the tutorial. So you're learning about how Miles is able to heal.
The healing comes in so much handy.
Yes.
I don't think that's in the first game because he doesn't have healing powers, right?
Yeah, he does not have healing powers in the first game.
Okay.
And that's the thing. At this point, we're getting a sense that time has passed from the first game. He's training. He kind of knows what he's doing, but he's still a novice and he's having these powers still develop within him.
With the melee as well, I notice, especially as you play through the game, dodge is a very important function. That's basically my go-to button for button mashing doesn't really work because there's so many different nuances and guns and, you know, cannons being shot at you or missiles or whatever. Dodge is the most important friend you'll have. So use that as much as possible. And then that's how you basically get a bunch of combos. I think that first fight with those goons, I managed to get a trophy for 100 plus combo.
Look at you.
That was just, again, pretty straightforward. Just dodge as much as possible and boom.
Yeah, and that's pretty helpful with, you know, the timing of your dodge, right? I think that's the hardest part. Timing your dodge in order to have those chain combat points within each fight. So your spidey senses will kind of have that radar for you. So you know exactly if a missile's coming to your face, if someone's going to shoot at you, if someone's just going to punch you. But right now, at this point, a lot of the enemies are pretty basic, other than Rhino.
Other than Rhino, yeah. They don't have too many weapons. It's not crazy. It, again, introduces you to the combat system. And it's pretty straightforward. Mm-hmm. But like you said before, we go to the mall, ride Rhino through the mall, which again, I wanted to mention, if that happened to you in real life, again, this whole paying for things, if you're a superhero, like how much money does a city have to pay? But imagine you're going to Sephora or you're going to Foot Locker or something and you're coming out with nice brand new pair of shoes and Rhino was coming at you full steam.
Yeah.
You're probably going to die. In the game, no one dies, You're probably going to.
Miles does this whole sliding move. You know, he's really good at trying to, and like every spider person, like Peter Parker, really when anybody is in the crosshairs of Rhino, Miles, because Spider-Man, Peter Parker's there. I'm like, they're both Spider-Man. Peter Parker's also in the mall swinging as well.
They're both named Spider-Man.
Yeah, so they're both kind of there, but Miles is on top of Rhino trying to navigate him out of the mall. And we see both Miles and Peter, they're just really good at either swinging things out of the way. So it moves like any other shoppers in the mall just to the side. Or Miles like does this whole like he slides onto the floor and then he web shoots a baby carriage out of the way.
Yes, the baby carriage is what I was going to mention. Slow-mo baby carriage save.
Yeah.
There was no baby in it though, from what I could see.
I don't think there was a baby. There was no crying. That must have been like the best baby.
Imagine the baby just flies out. And then he's got to web shoot the baby to save the baby back into the carriage. That would have been more fun than just dodging the baby carriage.
Exactly. But see, those tropes are in there. And although they may sound cheesy on paper, it works really well here. Yeah. And I love this whole sequence when they're chasing after Rhino because we're getting that kind of buddy cop feel between Peter and Miles, which we don't get a lot throughout the game as Peter's not there. But, you know, at this point, it's like one of those things that I actually did cherish, just seeing the two Spider-Men interact. Yeah,
that was fun, especially like their personalities. And Miles is not the funniest character, but, you know, Peter and both and him together, they create a dynamic that, again, like you said, buddy cop. I don't know who the bad cop is. Maybe Peter. I'm not sure.
I feel like maybe they're too good. It's just two good cops. There's no bad cop in this duo.
When you are going through the mall, there's actually a small Easter egg. I don't know if you caught it. I caught it the first time without having to look on YouTube or anything. Was the Insomniac logo was a chandelier in the mall that Rhino climbs onto and breaks. I thought that was a cool little nod to them.
Yeah, that was cool. I caught that one too. I'm wondering how much that chandelier was. How are they going to replace it? I don't know.
Again, we should probably tally up the amount of money that they destroy, that they have to spend to fix everything. I think next episode will count. No, that's going to be impossible. Rhino then crushes into a studio, and we get our first glimpse of J. Jonah Jameson. The first time ever, he was not in the first game. He was only in podcast form. And at this point, he's literally doing something maybe not so nice.
He's a menace. Too soft. He's a low-energy menace. Too easy. Maybe he's a weak-minded. Oh!
Hey, Jonah, looking good. Very festive.
Menace! A feckless, treacherous, unhinged menace, Jared.
Jonah Jameson is just, he's hilarious because he is always, he's holding just the facts, right?
But he's like, I think he was saying, he's trying to change his script so that it sounds like Spider-Man is worse than he is. He's like, what's this word? No, let's use this instead. Again, this is my great J. Jonah Jameson impression, but he's just basically a bad guy. Like, not, he's not a bad guy, but he's just an asshole, right?
Exactly. And he lives up to that legacy of that character, right? J.K. Simmons, obviously from the movies, is my Jonah Jameson, yeah, always. But this one, this Jonah Jameson really does embody everything that is just sipping on that haterade for Spider-Man. And I love it that although this glimpse of him is super quick, we already know, yes, that's the Jonah Jameson that we'd expect, yeah, to have in a Spider-Man game.
I had to look up the voice actor for it because I actually did think it was J.K. Simmons.
Oh.
It's not, but it's like an impression. But J.K. is basically the J. Jonah for our lifetime, right? Like, he's been in multiple Spider-Verses.
Yes.
I don't know, like, Marvel's teasing a couple multiverse stuff. I don't know if J. Jonah Jameson is going to be the same J. Jonah Jameson in every iteration, but I think he might be.
As he should be.
So after that little cameo, Rhino and Miles, still on his back, ends up knocking out Peter. And here we go. This is the moment of this first mission, where Miles and Rhino is mano e mano.
How am I even doing this? Selective sights? Some kind of field induction?
So he unlocks his special ability, Venom Punch, which at the time we don't know is actually Venom Punch. We don't know the term for it, but it's some electrical magnetic power that Miles has, which is pretty much super overpowered.
Mm-hmm. And it's Miles' signature, that ability for the Venom Punch. And it's classic superhero writing. At a point where he feels, you know, this fight may be lost, we see that power.
It's always the trope in any like hero movie where they unlock a power because they're either have no chance left or they're super angry and they're emotional.
Yes.
And then the Super Saiyan comes out. That's basically what it is. And it was great. I was like cheering while I was playing.
Yeah. And this is a point of the combat that just feels very different than the other Spider-Man game, because obviously Peter Parker doesn't have a Venom Punch. As you play the game, it's such a crucial point to every fight. And it just looks really cool. The animation, yeah, looks always amazing whenever he is using this move. So it's just something I know I gravitated to. I don't know about you.
When I play video games that I'm super amped up on, when I do a move like that, I like shimmy in my chair. I go like, and I like move. Like I do some sort of weird move. My girlfriend laughs at me every time when I'm doing that. And it's L1 square together. That's how you use the Venom Punch. And again, we recommend using it at any time possible because it is super overpowered.
Exactly. It is. You know, it's only overpowered for a certain time. I think as we go through, the enemies kind of get a little smart and know how to,
yes,
have weapons and shields that really combat that.
But with Rhino specifically, it made the fight, again, like you said, you were on normal, but it made it feel like it was easy,
mm-hmm,
because you're riding around Rhino in the fight so that he hits walls. And then once you do that, you can use your Venom Punch and it's pretty much overpowered. I think you only have to do it two or three times and Rhino's basically done.
Exactly. And I don't know about you. I have a conspiracy theory about this moment because Peter, he kind of gets hit and he's out of this fight. I've seen Peter Parker's Spider-Man you know, kind of get knocked out in other fights, but just get up at that right moment. I feel like Peter Parker's like, I'm going to sit this one out. That Venom punch looks really cool. I think Peter Parker was okay the whole time.
Maybe he was testing him. He's like, let's see what he does. If he gets crushed, then maybe I'll help him.
Exactly.
But you're right. Because I think, yeah, a little too long. Normally, he would get up way quicker than that. That's a good point.
He would. We also see that a jacket being totally mangled in this fight as well. You see the cotton out of it. I love all those little aspects of it. You know, we often see with superheroes, their suits never get dirty.
No. Yeah.
Never get dirty. They're always just pristine. The shine, you know, they're glowing. But no, in Miles Morales, his suit definitely gets roughed up.
I mean, there's been a couple. Tobey Maguire, Spider-Man, the first movie, his is pretty wrecked up. But yeah, like you said, like it just seems like it never gets dinged up. And it's good to see that. It finally shows the cost of what they're fighting for, which is their costumes.
Exactly. And then we have to wonder who's sewing up this jacket for him. I'm pretty sure his mom's going to think something's weird.
There's so many little nuances that, like, again, you know what that reminds me of? We never see characters in movies or games go to the bathroom. Why is that? We all go to the bathroom, Why isn't there, you know, number one or number two time where you have to press X and go to the bathroom?
Exactly.
It's realistic.
It is realistic. And quite frankly, if you have a superhero saving New York so many times, just give them their own stall. Okay. Yeah. So that no one has to know their identity.
So once we beat Rhino, we get to Simon Krieger, who owns Roxxon, and he talks to Peter and Miles, and instantly we have a feeling about him.
Simon Krieger, head of R&D at Roxxon Energy. Pleasure to meet you.
You too. Sorry, I think our ball landed in your yard.
No, actually did us a favor. We just bought the place, we're planning to tear it down for a build, but looks like you beat us to it. I wanted to thank you, both of you. Taking down Rhino? Solo? You are going places, bud.
Thanks. But he's still dangerous.
Nah, we'll hold him for the police. You know, I always think these super troopers are overkill until something like this happens. Oh, duty calls. Hey, really great to meet you both.
So instantly, he's evil, right?
Obviously. You don't just pull up to a burning building in a black SUV with your shoes shined, a scarf on your neck, no worries in the world, and not be the villain.
And it's the same thing, too. He's like, catch you later, guys. Like, oh, I just meant Spider-Man's, but I don't really care about you because I got lots to do right now. Don't worry about the mask. I got it. Like, okay.
Exactly.
All right, Simon. Yes. That's your real name.
Simon, jerk. Who's just ordering everybody around, all of his people just show up. A little too convenient, if you ask me.
He's got a lot of Elon Musk, Jeff Bezos vibes, 100%. Just to me, that's what I'm just saying.
Yeah, and, you know, they're continuing on with, you know, in Spider-Man, whatever iteration you're playing, watching, you know who the villain is. You know a character is probably going to be either a hero or an antagonist to Spider-Man. And they put that right in here. What he's saying, right? He's like, all right, like, I got to go. I don't care that, you know, this building was pretty much almost blown up. I don't care that all my employees might have been hurt.
Yeah.
I don't care about the cleanup. I'm out, peace, kind of thing, right?
I'm on a call. Oh, sorry.
Yeah, exactly. I'll see you later. I'll see you later. So it's just a little too convenient. My thing is, Miles nor Peter kind of never got the sense that, that's kind of odd that this guy doesn't care about, you know, this Rhino kind of barging in and making this building go aflames.
Listen, when you make as much money as Simon Krieger, it doesn't matter. I'm sure he can fix that all up and it doesn't, you know, take anything out of his pocket whatsoever. So he doesn't care. He's just cool guy, super with his jeans and his whatever, you know, he's cool guy billionaire. But we finish the mission with a little heart to heart, you know, and this is when Peter reveals to Miles that he's going on vacation.
Oh, man. Yeah, sorry. I've been meaning to tell you. I'm not going to be around for the next few weeks.
Is this some kind of pee joke I don't get?
No. MJ's headed overseas for the Bugle and requested me as her photographer. Kind of a working vacation for us.
Oh, man. Look, I don't know if I'm ready to fly solo. I screwed up today big time with the helicopter.
But then you delivered big time. You saved my bacon, Miles.
I got lucky.
Hey, I did this gig for 8 years without backup, and you better believe I screwed up lots of times. But that is how you learn.
That kind of made me a little emotional there with the little, when the little sound comes in, it's like, doo, doo, doo.
Yeah.
I'm like, oh, I like these guys. But do you think Miles is ready for this and being by himself as the only Spider-Man in New York?
Well, I feel like, you know, how Peter put it, are you ever ready as, you know, a startup Spider-Man? Probably not. You kind of have to get thrown into these situations. You can't go to, you know, Hobgoblin or Doc Ock and be like, hey, I'm not ready for this fight. Do you mind we reconvene maybe in 3 months' time after my training, right? I feel like Miles is as equipped as he would have been if he waited after Christmas, or if, you know, this happened before Christmas. It's just kind of, you have to be thrown into this.
Is it being thrown in, though, or maybe they should be doing more side missions like this together before, you know, just a run, couple run-throughs before the actual main event? That's my only thing.
I see what you're saying. So you feel like maybe this is Peter's fault for not training him more.
Yes, because he only saw what Miles could do on his own one time and then was like, gotta split. But also, was he going to tell Miles this even if the Rhino stuff didn't happen? Because then Miles wouldn't even be even more ready.
That is right? True. That is true. So really, Peter's kind of being selfish, but maybe he's able, you know, all those years defending New York on his own, it is time for a vacation for Peter. Yeah. So maybe Peter's just like, hey, I can't do this anymore. This is my first Christmas as Spider-Man.
Again, he doesn't have vacation leave. He doesn't have Pat leave, nothing.
Exactly.
He's just got to always work.
He just got to go. And you know what? I feel like this is the right direction for a Miles Morales game. We wouldn't want a Miles Morales game where you have Peter Parker as this figure that's in the game but not in the game. You would have questions of, okay, well, why is Peter Parker not on this adventure with Miles? I love that they said, okay, he's gone. And it's reasonable. He wants a vacation.
Yeah.
It's very relatable. He just wants to get out of the city, right?
And then we're left with a cool little end shot of Miles and a rotation of looking at the scenics of all of New York to the song On My Own, which I googled, by Jaden Smith, who does a lot of the soundtrack featuring Kid Cudi. And this song is a banger. It's my favorite of the entire game, and they play it right off the top, and this is where I felt super pumped before getting into the rest of this.
Yeah, I feel like I wouldn't expect this of Jaden Smith, but he did a really good job.
Yeah, you have something against Jaden Smith, I think.
I think I watched too much South Park.
Yeah. Plus, he's like Will Smith's son, so, you know, he grew up rich, whatever. Maybe we're jaded a little bit, I don't know. All right. After the break, we give our final thoughts on Mission 1.
The city late at night hit a pinnacle. Shining on them, I'd rather drip alone. Put those on game who didn't know the true form of pure evil's invisible, so I keep a lot of vision.
Welcome back to AutoSave, and now we give our final thoughts of this mission. We look at our brains after this. They're not mush yet, and I feel good. But how easy or hard did you find this mission, Camille?
Like I said off the bat with the combat, I felt it was fairly easy. Although I will say my PlayStation 5 did kind of freeze up when Rhino was introduced. So that was kind of a growing pain.
Oh no.
Because then I had to restart the game from the beginning. But after I got over that and you know, you're just looking at the game as, you know, itself in this mission, it's pretty easy. It's just an intro to this world. It's an intro to the move sets that you have. It's an intro to Miles and where he's at right now. So I kind of went expecting, like every game, you have a tutorial, and this was it.
The mission was a long one. It was roughly around 20 to 25 minutes of gameplay, rather that took you longer or shorter, which I really liked. It felt like a cold open to a show, which I love cold opens. Mm-hmm. And it really pumped me up for what's going to come and invested me into this game. Because I remember like putting my headphones down and I had just like a deep breath because I was like, oh my God, I'm in love. This is amazing.
I think the music as well had a huge part to play in that. The soundtrack accompanying you through this with the like instrumental, like you mentioned, the kind of sad theme for Miles Morales. It's just all those cues are just met really well. Insomniac did a really great job of that. And it just sucks you in that, yeah, you may need that moment where you take off the headset or after this mission, you're just like, whoa, I need to play more. And that was kind of my sentiment. I was like, this is so good. I want to play more.
Some key tips, I guess, for players. We mentioned most of it, which is there's no stealth yet, which will happen, but it's mostly hand-to-hand combat. So keep that in mind. Use dodge to dodge bullet fires and melee attacks at the same time. And again, what Camille said earlier, use Venom Punch as soon as you get it because it gives you a big advantage. Is there anything else tip-wise that we're missing?
Enjoy the scenery.
Yes.
It gets pretty hectic throughout the game. So usually in the first few missions, it's a great opportunity to kind of enjoy the scenery. Also, I really do like this kind of DIY suit of Miles.
Yeah.
So enjoy that as well.
What do we feel like after this mission about OG Spider-Man versus Miles? Do we feel more of a connection with Miles than we do with Peter? Do we feel bad for Miles? Or do we hate Peter now that he left him alone? I don't know. I'm getting mixed signals.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
You have mixed feelings about Peter?
I think so. First, it's because he looks different from the first game. I'll mention that, which pisses me off because he looks like Tom Holland, but he also, I was reading a few YouTube comments of some playthroughs, and a lot of it was, why does Peter look younger than Miles? And I thought that was funny.
Yeah, he looks like Tom Holland. They did that. They recasted, I guess, the facial scan actor. So I think they said it was a scheduling thing, but whatever. I liked the older model of Peter better just because it was more aligned with what we've seen Peter Parker to kind of be. Mm-hmm. And I think the fact that you have a different face that is not similar to Spider-Man in the MCU kind of helps with integrating you into this world. So immediately when you get that reveal with Peter Parker without his mask and you're like, Tom Holland? For me, the theories, I'm like, okay, so is this Miles Morales in the MCU? Is this a part of the
multiverse? No, don't go to that path. No.
I went down that path, but now I'm out of it.
Is this canon? Is this not canon? I hate this sometimes. Like, it's just like, if you ever watch Easter egg videos of like Marvel movies or Marvel shows, it's like, and then at 6:46, this happened. Is this canon?
Yeah.
It was a carton of milk that he touched. Does it mean anything? I don't think so.
But it's the same carton of milk that Miles Morales in Spider-Verse. Yeah. I did go through that a little bit. But once you get over it, and as the game progresses, I think we'll get used to this Peter Parker. And it won't bother you that much. I feel like Peter is a really great mentor. Although he's going on vacation, I feel like he's not gone. Yeah. I'm still with Peter and Miles being, you know, buddy cops, both good cops in this duo.
Okay. Maybe I'm being devil's advocate. I don't know. But Peter does say he's been doing this for 8 years. So again, the older looking Spider-Man from the first game, he looked like he was 24, 25, like he was out of college,
yes.
More matured. This one, he looks a little bit younger, but so he's in his mid early 20s. So he probably started around 14 and 16 if he's been doing it for 8 years. Miles is 16 in the game. So I guess like putting in Peter really understands what Miles is going through, I guess, especially since he did it at around the same age. So again, that's why he thinks he's ready. And then I wrote down here in my notes, Peter, a millennial, and Miles is a Gen Z. They can't get along. They can't get along. They hate each other on TikTok already, so it's not going to work.
I was going to say, I feel like Miles would have a TikTok. Like, knowing Miles, I feel like he'd have a TikTok. He'd upload some of his DJ sets on there. People would be creating dances of it. But yeah, there is this common understanding between the two because they went through, well, Peter went through the same thing around Miles' age. And that's why I feel like if there's anyone that's going to understand if Miles is ready, if Miles could be on his own, it's going to be Peter Parker. And Peter Parker, like you said off the top, he's a good guy. He's like the best kind of structure for what a superhero should be, you know, the goodest of the good. So I'm very hopeful for Peter going on his vacation. I think it's well overdue. He needs that time away from New York. Like, has he gone on a sunny vacation? Like, has he been on an island adventure?
No.
No. Hopefully in Europe he could find an island and, you know, just enjoy.
But normally what happens is they go to, you know, their vacation, wherever it is in the world, and then they have to fight something.
Yes, that's true.
It never ends for these people, which I feel bad for because the drama just carries them everywhere. But you mentioned both being morally good and Peter being morally good. And I think the most important part of that ending was the oath that Peter made Miles repeat.
What's this?
Christmas present. But first, you gotta take the oath.
Oh. Okay.
I promise to do everything in my power to protect this city.
I promise.
That's it?
That oath a real thing.
Totally. Definitely didn't just make it up.
Really shows, especially you could see in their eyes, because again, these graphics are good, that they're both morally good characters, and Peter trusts Miles, and they both, because they've been in such similar situations, losing people that they love, that they're willing to put it all on the line. And I think Peter understands that with Miles and trusts him because of it.
I couldn't agree even more.
I feel a little sentimental.
I know. I was like, can I now take this moment to just cry? Because that's beautiful.
Is there anything else we missed or you wanted to touch on before we depart?
Just, again, graphics look amazing in this game. It makes me want to go back and play this mission now again.
I forgot to mention, but the sunsets are beautiful.
Yes.
The aesthetic is just visually pleasing. But that's it for us. Camille, it's been a pleasure for our first ever episode. Anything else you'd like to tell the listeners, Camille, before we go?
Stay tuned because we have lots coming up, and a best friend to Miles as well.
Hey, dude, I am so filling your suit with snow. Are you still wearing your suit?
Yeah, you know, just in case.
That's right. We get to meet our best friend, Genki. Thanks for listening to this episode of AutoSave. We'll talk to you next time. AutoSave is produced and hosted by Camille Salazar Hadaway and myself, Nick Andrade. The show is also produced by Dylan Wilson. Gameplay and additional elements provided by Chris Seitzer. Executive producer, Clayton Hansler. You can follow the show at AutoSave Podcast on Twitter and AutoSave Pod on Instagram, YouTube, and Twitch. You can subscribe to the show wherever you're listening to it right now, and if it happens to be Apple Podcasts, kindly leave us a rating and review, but only if it's good. AutoSave is a Soda original, hosted on the Soda Podcast Network.
AutoSave.